I come back to that later on, but when we talk about more in detail about the modules, what that actually means in terms of countries and nationalities. Methods to teach and to learn. Basically, it should be possible to learn most of the contents by attending face-to-face courses as well as to learn by oneself. This is one of the key things what we developed within this project, saying that we have the face-to-face approach, but also the self-learning part. And during the piloting, we found out that that might not be enough, especially in caregiving. For example, and you will see that later on when I talk about piloting as well, what is missing, or not really missing, but what is also needed is the approach to actually do the action. That means a hands-on experience on what you actually do. It might be suitable to start the career as a PCG with a basic course, where one can learn about the requirements and knowledge and skills, and a course in the first aid. This should be in form of a guided seminar, for example, be it face-to-face or be a web-based course. A large part of the prepared content will be prepared for self-learning, as you know, blended learning. They can read or look at videos and discuss with the tutor or trainer. So a good success of learning will be assured. In this way, PCG can achieve a range of knowledge, skills, and competences to be able to do a responsible and satisfying job. Which mode is chosen depends on the interest and individual goals of the person to become a PCG. So the MCAT training consists of following steps, and as already mentioned before as well, all low-skilled job seekers, nurses, current PCGs, expresses interest in becoming a PCG or improving his or her skills. They access the MCAT portal, which you can find here under the address mentioned. Before we allow a person to start the training, we perform a pre-assessment of the competences and the suitable legal and health checks of a PCG candidate. This includes assessing in what modules the person has experienced and their expertise. This is the so-called online pre-assessment tool. We already described that as well. Once approved, the trainee can start his training either face-to-face, the classroom or remotely, online training platform with embedded dynamic core, and the condensed modules are available under these on the PCG learning portal. When doing the practical training exercises, or while being on the job, that's what I mentioned as well, the potential PCG can still access training material anywhere, anytime through the mobile application. The mobile application, including assistive technology, support services, enhanced with an embedded gaming element. The PCG, or potential PCG, share experiences and good practices together with a person with a disability via didactical or dedicated for linked to the different curriculum modules. Also on the MCare portal community, also already introduced from Adrian, where he can share his experience and put in what he thinks is a new content. How does it all work? If you look at this chart, you see, for example, someone who is looking for a new job, a new challenge in his working life, you have, for example, a low-skilled job seeker. He goes through the pre-assessment. That's what we already mentioned before. So he has to check what kind of skills he has already got. Is he actually, at the end of the day, interested in the job or not? So he faces several questions in the pre-assessment, referring to legal issues or health checks. Then he goes to a vet center to be trained as a personal caregiver. There then, he will be presented with blended learning, for example, face-to-face training and online learning. And then we do a self-assessment, which is not here, which we developed during the process of developing the whole contents. And we said it would be a good idea to have a self-assessment within the course of a PCG training. And at the end, we have a post-assessment assessment of competences on the job. PCG will meet the requirements to gain the certificate. And the person, the caregiver, goes home. Beneficiary goes to home of the beneficiaries, for example, people with disabilities or older people, and then can provide the service. So while he is at work, the course is finished, but he can still, of course, use a mobile application. And we said that this mobile application has a different rule to the online portal. The rule of the mobile application is basically, like now we call it maybe a wiki. So you go to the side of the patient, you sit there and you're not very sure what to do next in a certain situation, so you can put in the keyword and it pops up a little instruction. But then again, it interferes with the communication as well. That means you have to explain to your client what you're actually doing, so that you're not playing, you're not doing your job. So what you actually do with a tablet PC, you're actually looking up what to do next to provide the correct service to the requirements in this particular situation. So communication is the key, especially using a mobile application with all the negative issues it might have at the moment, that people, you know, when you go into the subway, for example, people playing along with their mobile phones, etc., etc. And the PCG is not actually doing that when using a tablet. It's not playing as such. It's looking up contents and material, what to do next. So that has to be explained to the client. So what is the role of vet providers and nursing schools? Basically the ones who provide the training. Vet providers and nursing schools may benefit from the PCG curriculum by organizing courses. Especially online learning enables training providers to offer courses independently from space and time. The other role that providers in nursing or nursery schools can take is to create assessment situations or to discover and to recognize knowledge, skills, and competences already achieved to fulfill the important requirements for the recognition of prior learning. That means a lot of vet centers, for example, provide services and different or learning contents as well. Here we provide them with new contents and give them the tool as well to assess what the potential PCG already knows in that particular field. Assessment, learning facility. Now the vet provider and may organize well-prepared assessment tools for to discover and to validate previous learning results. And the mobile learning does not work by itself, that's already said. So it is not the thing you should download only and then play along and say, oh, now I'm a PCG. It is a supporting tool within the learning process and after you've done the whole course. So set up a course, very transparent and clear in problem solving for the users, the vet providers, and prepare the target groups for an interesting but also demanding process of emerging into the world of mobile media by using it independently and self-committed for own capacity building. So that means for add-ons within the learning process. And again, the tablet PC is not seen by quite a few number of our target group as a learning device. It is seen as a research device or gaming device, etc. So that has to be explained that this is actually a learning device in this context. The core idea of mobile learning, of MK project is to make learning content available in small and easy to handle units available on smartphones or tablets. It's also possible to use it on smartphones, but then it is a challenge for your eyes to read it on the small screen instead of a larger one. So a PCG, but also a care person will be able to learn about special questions, checklists for special activities or appropriate use of assistive technology. The requirement to install this kind of mobile learning is that the person aimed at are capable to make responsible and correct use of it. That's what I already described. This can be a challenge for the caregiver, but also an advantage, an additional benefit for the care person who gets access to a new world of online content. And pay attention, of course, when using the mobile device, That's what I said, that you explain it to the client what you're actually doing.
Why you doing it?
The challenge that there is, there is a large challenge to address the mentioned target group with a demanding training in order to become a good PCG. Especially the methods and materials to be used has to be found and brought into a mode of easy accessibility and basic understanding. There are already very good examples in the available modules. There will be more when the platform PCG Care EU will be active, which is already now, since everyone will have the opportunity to contribute contents to the application. Okay, I skip this a little bit to be a bit faster. And come to the modules. Adrian already started to describe some of the modules. The challenge we had at the very beginning, or even during the course of developing this, the modules, was that there are different, let's say, laws and issues in different countries involved in this project. Some actions might be daily work for PCGs in one country, and not so in another. Some have an maybe an ethical codex in one country and not in another. So that was we will see later on. That was a challenge. We tried to eliminate as much as possible by saying when the content is translated into the national languages, and you already saw that. Then you have the translator or the team around the translator has to pay attention to this. That all the content is then suitable to the national law. And that's very important because there is still a variety of national laws in that field within Europe and also in Turkey as well. So the first module, again, to all the modules are interlinked, but also you can use them separately, individually. As we said, the learner, when we does a pre-assessment, and you will find out what he or she actually needs. And sometimes it is only a fraction of all the modules provided here. So the first module is a didactical support for mobile learning module. So the contents, this module provides information on the MCare learning material and tools. But that means it is all. What is it all about? What does the online platform do? What does the mobile application do? How is it presented? How is it supposed to be used? And at the end, once the module is carried out, the PCG should be able to understand when and where can the MCAT training tools be used. And harness the potential of an innovative educational approach. A very important one is a disability awareness. Adrian already addressed that as well. Within our team of partners, we discussed several times what is a disability. Where is it not maybe in a more ability or a restricted ability? Or what is it? So that is one of the key competences of PCG should be aware of, that there are first of all different approaches, different views, on what is actually a disability, and then how to address this. For example, this module provides an overview of the disabilities, also those related to aging, and the respective limitation and various people with these disability face. To cover topics that will help PCGs to upgrade their knowledge and understanding about different types of disabilities. And this will allow them to work independently, be aware of certain challenges they may face, and avoid discriminative practices. Sometimes it's a question of wording. Sometimes you're not aware of what you're saying. For example, I know from my dear colleagues, when you talk about or talk with blind people, is it appropriate to say phrases like, as you can see? So all these ethical things, and we discussed it as well, and Petra would know that this is, of course, seen differently as well, but in general it is okay because it's a phrase, but take take away that people have to be afraid when facing disability is one part of this, to make them aware what kind of disabilities are and what are the restrictions. So what should the PCG be able to do at the end? Increase his or her awareness towards different types of disabilities and the challenges and barriers associated with a particular disability. React appropriately in different life situations while working his or her client with his or her client with a disability. Understand how the person with disability feels, and that's what the settler was just saying, and what they consider important for their autonomy. Very important in the whole process is then, of course, in module 3, communication. And communication is a two-way street. It means you can not only provide information, you also have to receive information. And that could be feelings, that could be, also advice by the recipient how to do certain things. So communication is, of course, the key. And what you should be aware of as well is that you have, that's why we chose this picture, you have a sender and a receiver. And in the middle, there might be a filter. So you understand what you want to understand, or what you think you understand, and you give information what you think is appropriate. So that might be different from the view from the recipient or from the sender. And to make people aware, this module is also about that. It is dedicated to the basic communication between the PCG, as the basic one, and her client with a disability. The communication is the base of interaction between people, no matter if they have a disability or not. This module is providing information regarding effective and efficient communication with contributes to the successful provision of services. And that is always the key. The center of everything is the recipient. And that's what we all do. We try to learn now and provide the correct service. And not the other way around. We don't learn to gain more knowledge. It's nice to have, but it's not the aim of this project or the objective of this project. And support self-confidence while creating a positive emotional background. The content. In the process of communication with a disabled client, a feedback of communication, meaning by two-way street, is given and received. Behavior is being evaluated. Emotions and experience of the others are being influenced. The module is providing information and guidance about how to establish good contacts and develop your community skills, which is extremely important to demonstrate a helpful and passionate attitude towards clients with disabilities. And this goes especially to people, to the low-skilled people we are addressing, giving them tools how to communicate. So the PCG should be made aware to use correct terminology towards people with disability, able to initiate and maintain effective, efficient, and non-judgmental as well communication with the client, able to establish effective verbal and non-verbal contacts, and how to react and how to respect clients' needs. Yeah. Policy, I think we know about this. Adrian already explained it a bit in more detail. I think I can skip through that you know and go what the PCG should know at the end. He or she should know which are the regulations existing on EU and national level, and adapt, and that's important, and adapt the contents accordingly as well, maybe. So use it in the correct way. And that support and social integration and rehabilitation of the client with disability. You know how to assist the client with disability in applying for social benefits and assistive technologies. Social inclusion, also described by Adrian. I can go a little bit faster. I don't know how much time I still got.
I will shout when you're interested.
Okay. So this module will provide the PCG the basic knowledge about the social inclusion. The PCG receives specific information about strategies to enhance inclusion, what social factors in inclusion promotes, and promote inclusion and various. of the module is to train, of course, the PCG about the needs of social inclusion of people with disabilities in the elderly, and give some ideas about how to support and encourage those people in their social inclusion. I can give a little example, for example, of elderly homes. In Germany, we talk about elderly homes of the fourth generation. So, I spare you the first three, but the fourth generation basically is that the care given in the elderly homes is adapted to the need of the potential, let me call, client. So, and it will be raised or adapted, still adapted to what they need. For example, if you're still able to walk and to cook, etc., you can go into an elderly home, have your own flat, and provide your own services at home as long as possible. It means you can live there, and if you need more support, then you can use more support by saying, for example, I'm not able to cook anymore because I have a disability which does not allow that anymore for me. So then you can have someone providing you the service, either cooking for you, or you use the canteen more regularly. If you're unable to walk anymore, then you can adapt to that, for example, by getting assistive technology or a helping person to adapt to whatever needs you have, to get you out of the room, out of the bed, into the wheelchair, etc., etc. If you're not able to do that anymore, then of course you can have a full-time caregiver to adapt to that as well. So that means, according to your needs, you will have the appropriate service delivered. And this is also very important here. And then, working in the social field, psychological empowerment is one of the keys. The personal caregiver might not be aware of what he's going to face in terms of hygiene, in terms of disabilities, in terms of caregiving, what you have to give, etc., etc. And of course, you have to address that too. This module will give the PCG practical information in order to treat the client with kindness and respect. It will guide guide the PCG on the way to psychological empowerment, so that after the end of the module, the PCG will be more confident and less stressed as a result of the work as a PCG. It also consists of a number of topics related to the ethics, as well as the guidance how to identify a person's needs and desires of the client with disabilities. A major part of the module is dedicated to the prevention of depression, which frequently occurs in the work with these hard groups. Another part is dedicated to sexuality, and the material highlights the ethical aspects that, in case there is a sexual relationship between the client and the PCG should withdraw as a professional. That's what we recommended within our work. But on the other hand, we also discussed the issue, is it appropriate to, let's say, clients have an intimate relationship? Is that wanted? Is that even allowed by law? And that might be in different countries. But we also addressed that and said, in general, of course, they're human beings. So it's et cetera, et cetera. You see in what depths we discussed the content. A topic related to coping with stress is also addressed in the content of this module. In an illustrative way is using tables and examples. Upon the completion of the module, the PCG will know useful tips how to help the depressed elderly, as well as how to distinguish depression and dementia. Further, see what is expected from the PCG at the end of the module, that he or she can treat the client with kindness and respect, be aware of the ethics, understand the factors that lead to depression and signs of dementia, understand the recognition of signs of abuse, understand and recognize signs of a possible potential suicide. This is very advanced stuff for a PCG, as I said at the beginning, that we're addressing low-skilled workers. I mean, it's very high standard to find out if someone has signs of a possible or potential suicide. Know how to react in case of dying and death of his or her client with disability. That's also very important. psychological needs is also complementing to the psychological empowerment, provides a PCG the basic knowledge of psychological needs of a person with disabilities and the elderly in separate units. So there's information given about physical status, nutrition, toileting, changing diapers, health monitoring and technical assistance and knowledge. What should you know, or she? The basic knowledge of general psychological needs and how to help them in different situations. Hygiene?
A short correction. So, module 6 is psychological needs, because it's rather short, and module 7 is physiological needs.
Sorry.
I see some people looking straight, but notes and now as well.
So then hygiene. This module will provide the PCG the basic knowledge of general hygiene. In separate units, the PCG receives specific information about general principles, sources of infection, routes of infection, infectious diseases. Also, learning topics of individual hygiene are addressed: how to wash hands, disinfect your hands, how to shower, take a bath, how to deal with food refusal, etc. The PCG knows the knowledge, the basic knowledge of general hygiene, how to protect themselves from infection, and how, by what specific action, the PCG can prevent an infection of the person with disabilities or the elderly. Daily care at home. This module will provide the PCG the basic knowledge of daily care at home. The PCG is taught how the house is cleaned quickly and thoroughly. There are recommendations given when and how often to clean something, and also requirements which have to be considered in terms of hygiene. The PCG at the end should know the basic knowledge of their daily care, know general hygiene requirements, when and how often the PCG has to clean something, how to use the content and timing constructive cleaning plan, special tips and tricks how to keep the clean in the daily care in-house, the daily care in-house easier. First aid at risk was one of the modules we did this year. We talked about in depth because there are different standards in our different countries. But what is this module addressing? This module will give the PCG essential information on the provision of first aid and the risk which the PCG may face during the provision of reliable services. First aid is know-how which permits the PCG to recognize a dangerous situation, for the client with disabilities to communicate the alert to medical services, and to prevent a worsening condition of the casualty waiting for medical care.
Your voice is getting harsh.
Thank you very much. So, first aid know-how, which permits the PCG to recognize a dangerous situation, as I said, is very important. And we have to be aware of that the PCG is not a doctor, it's not a psychiatrist. He is someone who might notice something, or hopefully notice something, and then knows what to do next. And that's what we have to address here as well. The module consists of dedicated sections related to clients with learning difficulties, which are considered as the most vulnerable group in terms of their health care. Module 10, in this module 10, these are one of the cases or the recipient has to know some tips or some things about. For example, choking, what to do in case of choking when my client chokes. What to do when my client has fallen or fell. Or severe bleeding, nosebleeds. So maybe know some reasons why some of these symptoms, let's say, occur. Unconsciousness. cardiac arrest, cardiopulmonary. Okay, I'll tell you what. Then wounds, burns, fractures, shock. For example, the back, head, and neck. Electrocution, hypothermia, poisoning, and all things which have to be addressed in, can occur in the PCGs in daily work. At the end of the module, there is a guidance on how to prevent the enlisted risks, as well as how to store safely all medicines, cleaners, cosmetics, and household chemicals out of the reach of the vulnerable client with disabilities. Again, only where appropriate. If some of the clients are able still to clean and to use cleaning chemicals appropriately, then there is no need. But in the island, yes, there is. He or she should understand the concept of first aid, understand the main risks and treats towards people with different disabilities and conditions, how to act in case of risk or emergencies. And in addition to that, know when it is no more their shop. It's one of the important things to know. When should I call for help, for a specialist? So to train that, I think it's even more important, and train about risky maneuvers, which are not able to do anyway. The environment. This module will provide the PCG important practical information and tips on how to take into consideration all aspects of the environmental control. This includes how to act appropriately in case of hot and cold weather, which influences some specific clients' health conditions. My 90-year-old grandmother, for example, if it's very hot outside, she does not leave her house. And if she has to leave her house, she calls a taxi. Because she doesn't want to walk anymore in the heat, or she doesn't want to use a hot bus, etc. Or if she can't prevent it, and that's my 92-year-old grandmother, she uses a tablet PC to communicate. Easy to use. The module provides information about maintaining of a suitable temperature in a hot in the home environment. This influences particular types of disabilities such as lung diseases, systemic lupus. Oh, do we have to read this? No. Lupus, I know that, but the next. Okay, and osteoporosis. Reynolds phenomenon, pulmonologic diseases, etc. Furthermore, the module pays attention to the influence of specific medication in case of an inappropriate temperature. Again, it has to be paid attention to what is actually allowed according to national rules and laws to be carried out by the PCG. For example, medical in some countries, medication is not allowed to be given by a PCG. It also provides recommendations which can help the PCG to provide safe services and to advise the client on how to live healthy and how to avoid substance that can badly affect his or her condition, for example, alcohol, drugs, nicotine, or coffee. Another important part of the module is dedicated to overdressing and clothing while the client is doing his or her outdoor activities. He or she is also responsible for residential security and possible adjustment of the home environment. The module provides some practical information related to doors and locks, windows, home lighting, alarm systems, if any, and fire safety. The module ends with the useful guidelines in terms of possible usage of assistive technologies, for example, communication and medical devices. A safe tablet might be an easy solution for some people. At the end, the PCG should be able to control the home environment so that his or her client with disability is not affected by weather conditions, inappropriate indoor temperature, overdressing, or humidity. provide a secure environment for his or her client, preventing risks, for example, robbery, fire, or other threats, suggesting suitable communication devices or assistive technologies that increase the client's independence. Mobility in people with disability, in elderly people, in module 12, as we said, is one of the key modules for people, for especially for elderly people. This module will provide the PCG the basic knowledge of mobility and transfer. In separate units, the PCG receives specific information about general principles, mobility methods in and outside the bed, for example, transfer methods from or to the bed, to the wheelchair, to the bath, and to the toilet, and how to put on and off the orthotics. The PCG should know the basic knowledge of general mobility and transfer methods and how to help a person with disability and elderly people in different situations. Again, only apply as much help and assistance as needed, but not as much as possible. Leisure and daily activities. This module will provide to PCG the examples and the basic knowledge how to offer leisure and daily activities. Different ways of leisure and daily activities are shown depending on the needs of a person with a disability or an elderly person. As we said, there could also be, let's say, games or training sessions for the brain, etc., and also outdoor activities organized according to their ability of being able to walk and to be mobile. The PCG at the end should know the basic knowledge of leisure and daily activities and should have a variety of those available. The PCG understands the different needs and requirements related to the disability or age-related limitation and is able to decide on a suitable leisure activity. And last but not least, prevention of PCG burnout syndrome. Yeah, Adrian addressed it early on. This is one of the key modules. The contents this module will give the PCG practical information in order to cope and prevent you from an eventual burnout as PCG. First of all, he has to know what is burnout, of course. The content is related to causes leading to burnout and how it affects the PCGs. It gives you the necessary knowledge about frequent signs and symptoms of burnout, like less energy, a mental illness, exhaustion, little satisfaction of what you are achieving, further information about troubles in relaxing, impatience, and irritations are also explained. The author of the module are giving also important information to the so-called 3-half approaches and what the differences are between stress and burnout. This module also provides prevention tips, including relaxing, healthy eating, exercising, sleeping habits, as well as tips how to manage stress. In the end, the PCG should be aware of the signs and symptoms of a burnout syndrome, understand the importance of a burnout syndrome, and how it affects the quality of the provided services as a PCG, understand the differences between stress and burnout, and be aware of how to prevent a possible burnout. So, just to give you an overview, how 2 minutes? Just 1 minute? Okay, I'll do that very quickly. To give you an overview of how the module is structured. Now you learn about the contents a lot. And I hope you understand them and can take it all in, because it's a lot, because we worked on it 24 months and now we present it in a very short time. But it is very easily structured. For example, take the module 8, the hygiene module. There are the different units. Now, part 1 is about hygiene, part 2 about infection, part 3 disinfection and self-protection, part 4 disinfection hands, or disinfecting hands, and part 5 individual hygiene and shower, individual hygiene and full bath and partial bath, part 6, and food refusal of care recipients and suffering from dementia, part 7. To show you what part six, for example, looks like. Looks like this: individual hygiene, full bath. Has all the fundamentals from definition, what the job objectives, materials to be used, etc. We want to jump it to anonymous and mobile, and needs for assistance. For example, this: how much help is needed? Yes, David. When there's a detailed description, what to do next? We discussed in depth how to address this. And we said we should have it in the wording like an order, so that people reading it know what to do. So we have it, for example, here: stabilize with both hands on the rim of the bath tube or the bathtub, lift the leg nearest to the bathtub, etc. Move the balance point more to the bathtub and stand with this leg in the tub. Now move also the other leg into the bathtub and then sink slowly into the water. And then, in case of you need assistance, the carer leans, and you can see this, ahead as far as possible so that he can move easier his pelvis from the stool, etc., etc. You can see how the module is made. Module 12, part 3, is the standing, for example, standing up from the bed, standing from the chair, also addressed in the same way, standing in the bed, etc., how to stand up from the bed, standing from a chair. While walking with walkers or walking with crutches. Types of workers, different types of purchase. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Elias. Just a couple of things to clarify for everyone. So, in the module 4 about policies, this module was brought on board because maybe some of you were also at the athletic event, I think. Mark? For example, we were at Athletic Event, Jean-Marie was at Athletic Event as well. There was a previous project where we looked at the how to train people actually to be aware what exists about assist technology. And what we realized in that project, which ended like 1 or 2 years ago, 2 years ago, we saw that, first of all, people with disabilities are not often aware about what policy exists for them, what are their rights, they're not aware of that, especially when we talk about small villages, even in big towns. And also we saw there when we spoke with personal assistants that they're not aware of what are actually the applicable rights and laws for people with disabilities. So that's also why we have this model here. So although we skipped it very quickly, in fact this model is also core. Yeah? Let's not forget it is the week of people with disabilities, also next week, this European policy event for people with disabilities. We say by and for people with disabilities, but that also means that they have to be well informed. Okay? So I would like to emphasize that this model is actually very important. Being aware of your rights. Secondly, module 13, leisure and daily activities, is mainly addressing actually older people. Okay? I would like to make that clear. Because this project and also the training material that we have focuses on people with disabilities and older people. And initially, when we created the material, we thought we're going to make a difference. We're going to indicate whether training material is relevant for older people or for people with disabilities. And we had very thorough discussions with all the partners. Many of us are working with people with disabilities, or work in the rehabilitation sector, like for example, Berlin, or have, to personal reasons, are daily confronted with disability. Now, we realize actually that many of the aspects in terms of supporting, caring for a person are relevant for both. Because the older a person grows, the more we are being faced with disabilities. For example, myself have for 2 years arthrosis, which makes it very difficult for me to hold things in my hands, which in time to become worse. But this is aging. So the caring aspect that is relevant for young people with disabilities becomes relevant for an older person. I would like to emphasize. And then finally, That book, I really advise you to have a look at it. Do not take it with you, because this is we have two first prototypes. You go to introduce a whole bunch. These are two first prototypes. They're not the final versions. In that book, you will see that we followed a modular approach and not full text approach, because majority of personal assistants are people that are either low-skilled or do not have the time to start learning a whole course. For example, in the United Kingdom, there is a very good course for personal assistants. It's a full two-year course. You have to go every day to university. So you can imagine that the average person is not going to take that course. That's also why no one is going to that course, for some course. Years ago, there was also a course you developed in Belgium, probably a very good course. But if I remember well, it required 400 hours of training. There is no personal assistant who will be willing to spend 400 hours to become a personal assistant. We know that for practice. So that's why in this project as well, we go lower. But we try not to change the quality. But we go in a way that we approach it modular, with bullet points, and actually the main difference is also made by the trainer. And we'll hear that in the next presentation. That's why when we piloted this meeting, because we have to know how good it was, that we involved people that have worked with people with disabilities, that have been personal assistants, and that ensures that actually the training content is the basis, but the real added value is how it is being brought, how it's being taught. So I hope this clarifies some of the slides, because maybe some people got a little bit confused. We are now going to address the piloting. The piloting feedback, but what I would like to ask before, are there any questions for Andreas, regarding the content? Maybe we missed something, or maybe if something is not clear, please ask.
Or any contribution?
Yes. Joy.
I would have liked some more attention for the technology as well. So meaning a specific module, meaning technology for the PCG in of herself,
yeah,
as well as technology for the,
yeah,
the user, the person who is
careful.
Thank you very much.
So, Jean-Marie, within the application we have, because the project mainly focuses on care, we have embedded there the full functionality also to host a complete set of instructive material on assist technologies, relevant assist technologies. At this moment, it's not uploaded in the mobile app. You will see it's empty when you go in. But our Greek colleagues will ensure by the end of this year all, for example, Sfomata, all that supportive assistive knowledge is uploaded. Because indeed it's the case, if you're a personal assistant, especially when you start, you're faced, for example, with a person who's blind. Yeah, the person who's blind will talk about his screen reader. And if you don't know what the screen reader is as a personal assistant, I think there's a problem. If you don't know what the metallic nurses, then there is a problem. So there is, the model is in there, it is ready, we just have to put all the function there. So we have taken it into account. So I hope that will test some point.
But don't forget the technology for the PCG in reverse, so that the productivity of the job,
mm-hmm,
of working can be raised.
We come back, because I'm here now, I'm self-entertainer more or less, because the next presentation about piloting is also for me. But when we did the piloting, it was one of the things, one of the results we were referred to, that it is important that the PCG is has to do hands-on work, actually use technology, not only the tablet, also the other technologies, assistive technology, they are available. And I had attended a conference in Dublin just 2 weeks ago, which was about another project, but it was about assistive technology. And the tendency of assistive technology is going to so-called universal design, meaning that there is a general gadget, for example, but it is able to be personalized. So at the moment, it's a big challenge, of course, and there's also the different objectives involved of the makers and of the people in need, and on the other hand, of the science sector. different interests in that field, but on the other hand, it has to be very simple to use and very adaptable. One, we have of course assistive technology addressing different disabilities. But maybe there could be a design, for example, which makes it very easy to adapt to the different ones. For example, there was one example given for deaf-blind people. So how, I mean, that's very, very, very difficult how to create a device which is usable, first of all, by the client, understandable by the environment, and also being able to communicate in an easy way. So a university in Germany, in Berlin, developed such a device, which is very, very interesting. It's called a long hand. It's like a glove. It's like a glove, yeah, and you can use it like a, I would say, easily described as a mobile phone. When you tap or you press, and it gives feedback to the hand of the recipient, etc., etc. And the technology advanced so fast that now they are able to text in mobile application or receive texts. So that means you have now a multiple auditorium. You're not only be able to communicate one to one, you're also able to communicate. So these technologies are very new, very in the science sector still, but they are coming. And that's why I take this into account. It's very important to teach a PCG about these technologies, what is there to have, what is available, and then, on the other hand, how to use it. So it starts with very simple ones, like the metal nurse you described, or a wheelchair, for example, or maybe another device, even a bed, how to control it, that it goes up and down and to push it along. And then ends with high-tech, high-end devices as well. So that is a broad field, but we have to take into account that the PCG target group is low-skilled workers, so as well. That's a bit, yeah, it's a better field in that sense.
Maybe also to add, the way we have developed also the mobile application means that we can remotely change the contents. So that means, for example, because we also want to deploy this in Flanders on a commercial basis, and in that sense there also that we revisit everything that we have made, especially for Flanders, and we can actually, wherever we see this is not relevant or it should be extended, can easily update that, and it's immediately reflected in the mobile application. So unlike other European projects that deliver a mobile app or an app, and afterwards it's dead because it's not being updated, we do not have that dependence because we can directly log in online and we can change all the content of the mobile application. So I think this is a big advantage that I haven't seen it anywhere else. Not even in a big Horizon 2020 project or the big FP project, I've never seen this kind of approach. So this is also good. Also, if you go to the portal, you will see, I think it's called submit your ideas or submit your feedback. And what does that mean? We allow people to directly actually inject, you could say, their own content into the system. And when we see this content is relevant, we prove it and it's immediately published into the system. So this means actually the community can contribute, personal caregivers can contribute, people with disabilities, if they believe something is missing, can contribute, and this is provided for all languages. So it's like a bio atmosphere, let's call it, and everything works together with each other. But I think this is quite enough to this. But I've spoken enough. Any other questions?
Just a contribution maybe.
Yeah.
And as technology is a huge subject that has to be taken into account,
they will give you one.
Thank you. Assistive technology
closer.
Assistive technology is a good subject that we have to take into account all the disability groups, for deaf people, for people with physical impairments. So it's impossible to train all these low-skilled people according to assistive technology. So maybe we can have some units inside that module that we can separately explain what's needed in that specific group for the assistive technology, I think. For example, for cognitive problems, we have to talk about their communication. But for mobility, we have to take into account about maybe robotic rehabilitation technologies as well, or workers with assistive technologies. So it has to be taken into account.
That's a good point. In fact, for all that, we have the material for that is totally ready. So we have per main disability group, we have a range of, we call it typical assisting notes that is used by this target group. So we have that ready, it's a good point. So we put that in note. We bring that on board. Jean-Marie.
I agree with that, but the problem of most PCGs, they don't know, they need not to know all the use and the technical elements of the devices. But the main problem of the PCGs is that they are not aware of the existence of technology.
Exactly.
So if you can include that and give information where people can find more technical details, that's already a very huge point. So that's the problem. People are not aware of the existence.
So as I said, there is the separate functionality, but we could put a dark in disability awareness as well. Whereby this one specific section where we say the most relevant system knowledge. We took note of it, we will adjust it for the final. Thank you, Jean-Marie.
Thank you. Now the next speaker is I can invite Brian, but then you can
No, it's okay. If it's not too boring for the rest of you.
Okay, experience in piloting of the training material.
Which one of the presentations?
Very short explanation how we did, how we came to this point, and how then we did the part here.
So I gave you a broad explanation about the for information about the contents. Well, I think my voice is still. Maybe I don't need it. About the contents of the modules in this project. But the crucial point for the project itself was to test it, to find out if that is any good. And if yes, what can be improved, and if no, what has to be changed. And we faced the challenge, and because we didn't know what the outcome would be like. We know how much effort we put in, how much we tried to address all the different aspects introduced in the modules, but we did not know what the actual recipient on two sides, on one hand the trainers, on the other hand the PCGs, what they would think of the contents. So we faced that, and we said we have to test it, and we had a piloting phase at the end of the project, which just finished a few weeks ago. What I would like to talk about, for example, to introduce what the piloting was all about, then the piloting methods, what did we find, and what recommendations were given by the piloters to the project. So just like you, with their recommendation about taking into account the different technologies, etc., and they already had a feedback as well, what we should change, what should be addressed, should be added, should be taken out, etc. So what was the aim of the piloting? The aim was to test thoroughly the MCAD curriculum, training courses and materials, supported by the ICT-driven learning environments, online and mobile, during pilots in Belgium, Bulgaria, Germany, and Turkey. And here, in this presentation, I will address the German findings. And the other partners will then come forward and do their presentation. To establish a panel of at least 20 users in each country to provide the basis of a rigorous review of all aspects, qualitative and quantitative, of MCAD outputs as
designed and customized in work package 3, which I just reported before. And then produce revised national versions of the MCare offline and online resources in response to the result of the piloting in the aforementioned pilot sites. How did we approach all this? First, in our case, and I think all the others had it in a similar way, we had a preparatory workshop in Tamalbad, Wiesenbad, which is in Germany, in the Far East. We had then an informational workshop. I mean, the preparatory workshop was to prepare the piloting phase, and the informational workshop was about a workshop with the actual piloters, what we'd like to achieve, what the project is all about, because that was the first interaction with the project. Then, recruiting piloters, of course, even more. Instructional workshops, what we're going to do and how it's going to be done, what the time frame and time scope is all about. And then, the actual piloters. EVUB, as I mentioned in my introduction, is a network of 50 different organizations. And we have chosen two members, the CJD, it's a Christliche Jugendlocker, or a Christian Association of Youth Villages, and the International Bund Wehrenkreuz. And then, after piloting, had another workshop, collecting feedback and compiling it, and that we have condensed it, and this is the result here presented in this little presentation. In general, we had several findings. For example, when we looked through, and that it's partly due to the different approaches of the different partners in the in the phase of developing the material, also due to different countries and national settings, that some parts of the modules were too simple, but on the other hand, and contrary to that, too many technical terms are used for the target group beginners. Beginners and others. For example, as I think you saw, there are difficulties in all using the Latin names. In Germany, for example, there is for the medical issues, there is no Latin name in a general language. Latin names are for doctors. So when German patients, for example, they complain about that their doctors speak languages they don't understand when they're talking to their nurses. So, for example, this is just one part. So, but in other countries, for example, in England, I know, and in Britain, it is very common to use Latin phrases and Latin words for example, for diseases and illnesses. That's one of the findings. It is not sufficient, for example, to have only theory to understand the content of some modules. It is very important to assure practical experiences and examples. I already addressed that in the other presentation as well. You can learn in theory, of course. You can learn face-to-face as well. But you have to actually do the action to find out if you are suitable for it and if you are able to do it at the end of the day. Then, referring to the contents, we found that different definitions for certain illnesses, disabilities on national level are given. For example, and then imprecise definitions of certain diseases as well, also seen from a German perspective, I have to say, because from other perspectives it might be different, or it is different, you will see it. Then, of course, I've mentioned that as well before, we found that imprecise classifications of competences and needed qualifications of a different profession involved in caregiving. For example, what is a caregiver supposed to do or allowed to do? What is a physiotherapist supposed to do or allowed to do in the context of caregiving? What is a physician's job? What is a medical nurse's job? What is a doctor's job? What is a psychiatrist's job? And this, the interference and interlinks are very important to address when you train for PCG, because there are limitations, there are restrictions in law, also restrictions and ability what the PCG can do. So when there also there are, let's say, zones of overlapping where the PCG should be very responsibly and then, for example, if he recognizes a symptom or doesn't recognize a symptom of an illness, that he calls for help of an expert, of one of these folks. And professional qualifications are required for the different tasks, for example, as dressing wounds, diagnosis, prescription of medicine, therapy to be applied in different countries. That was one of the findings. Yeah. For example, in Germany, a PCG is not allowed to address wounds or take blood pressure or do any kind of diagnosis. Any kind of diagnosis. Meaning, for example, making assumptions from the color of the skin is not a PCG's job. So, that's, for example, is one of the core things we discovered, that there might be differences in the different countries. Or, yeah, very simple, what therapy should be applied. The PCG's job is to apply given therapy, or already prescribed therapy, but not to make a decision what therapy applies to the patient. So that has to be made very clear in the modules. That was one of the findings. Then, the content is not always adapted fully to the national standards. That's what we found for the German version, at least. As said, for example, methods of taking blood pressure or first aid numbers. Concerning mobile app, generally, we found, because we have the very first version, and there's now an updated version as well, but generally we found the tool is a very good additional tool to support the learning process. And as well, and that is not, it was not the purpose of the tool at all of the mobile app, it is not a self-learning tool. And there, because there is no guiding structures or tutorial, as I said before, it's only a kind of wiki. You can put in prompts, you can put in phrases, you can put in words, and it popped up what relevant contents there might be. But the actual content, learning content, is online portal. What is also positive about it, it gives a good impression of the first version concerning design and layout and handling. It is well structured and clearly laid out, and the search function already works well. All contents from the online portal is already transferred. What are the potentials? What we found a potential user might miss when using that device at the moment is some kind of tour guide. And when you remember when you had the first contact with a mobile app, sometimes when you install it and you open it up, there is a little tutorial or a little guided tour guiding you through the different contents, the different buttons, different icons, what they mean, etc., etc. Especially for the addressed target group of low skills people, it might be crucial to find out how the mobile app actually works from the first contact on. Then the contents of the mobile app and learning portal, sometimes in some versions, but now that is already